Christ is risen. Alleluia.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Welcome everyone as we gather to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord on Easter Day. Welcome to visitors we have with us this morning, and welcome to those who are joining us online. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in the innocent life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins. Strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of glory, fill your church with the power that flows from Christ's resurrection, that in the midst of this sinful world, it may signal the beginning of a renewed humanity, raised to new life with Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the sermon.
first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Now I should remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaim to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaim to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn have received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to someone untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them. Though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe, for the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, your word is a lantern to our feet and a light to our path. May it also be food for our lives. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Please be seated. For the last 10 years, I've been trying to avoid preaching from the pulpit, because it's a long way up here. But I can't preach where I usually preach, on the platform, because there's a great big green fuzzy cross in the road this morning. Apologies to Sophie and Imogen for calling it a big green fuzzy cross. It's actually called a living cross. And the idea is, as we know, on Good Friday, Jesus died on the cross. On Easter Day, he rose again, so the cross becomes a symbol today of life. And so you're invited, either just before you receive communion or as you're going back from communion, to place a flower on the living cross. And even if you're not coming up for communion, you're most welcome to come forward and to put a flower on the living cross. When Stephanie and Zoe and I were living in London, there was a television program that was very popular, and it was hosted by an Australian entertainer whose name you're not allowed to say anymore because he was found out to be a very naughty boy. But he was famous for tying up kangaroos and flogging British paints at one stage. But this program was very good and very interesting. What happened was that four amateur artists would come and they would paint a celebrity each week. And the idea was to be the best painting, and at the end of the show, the celebrity would choose the painting that they liked the best, and that would be the winner, and the artist would get a prize, and the celebrity got to take the painting home with them. And one of the things about this show that was interesting was that each of the four artists would paint the subject in front of them in very different ways. Sometimes the artist would paint in a very traditional portrait style, looked a bit like a photograph, and yet other artists would paint and use different ideas, colour and light, to paint the celebrity. Some of them looked like a Manet painting, or some like Klimt, or someone like that, or something like El Greco or Rembrandt, and so on. So it was amazing how they were all painting the one subject, and yet the paintings were very different. And that is a bit like the four Gospels. The four Gospels are about the one subject, Jesus Christ. And yet each of the gospel writers, the evangelists, paint their subject in very different ways. They use different parables, different stories, different sayings of Jesus, different incidents within the life of Jesus to paint their own picture of who Jesus is. So when people ask me, well, you know, the four Gospels, they're so different. Why are they so different? I talk to them about this painting show, because in a very similar way, the Gospel writers have painted their subjects very differently. And this is true of the resurrection accounts in each of the Gospels. One of the distinctive features of the resurrection story in John's Gospel is the central place given to Mary Magdalene. She was witness to Jesus' death, and the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark and Luke, tell us that she, along with the other women, also saw where the body of Jesus was laid. All four of the biblical accounts indicate that Mary Magdalene was one of the first at the empty tomb. In John, she appears to be the only one, while in the other three Gospels, there are other women mentioned as being at the tomb on Easter morning. In John's account of Easter morning, we are told that Mary Magdalene has gone to the tomb where Jesus has been laid. We are not told why Mary has gone to the tomb. It would appear from the fact that it is mentioned four times that she is crying, that she has gone to mourn. Mary, on arriving at the tomb, sees that the stone has been removed and comes to the conclusion that Jesus' body has been stolen. Grave robbing was quite common at that time, and so it would have been natural for Mary and the other disciples to come to the conclusion that someone had stolen Jesus' body. She runs to the disciples and tells them that Jesus' body has been stolen. In response, Peter and the other disciple, who is also referred to in John as the beloved disciple, run to the tomb. The other disciple gets there first and stands at the entrance. Peter, in usual Peter fashion, barges in, but doesn't seem to understand what is happening. The beloved disciple enters the tomb after Peter, sees the linen wrappings, and believes, but without understanding. It's not clear what he believes or how deeply. We only know that he sees and believes. Peter apparently doesn't believe or understand. They return to their homes, and Mary is left to grieve alone once more. Yet she is not alone, as when she looks into the tomb, she sees two angels, though she apparently doesn't recognize them as angels, and still believes that someone has taken Jesus' body away. They ask why she is grieving. After answering them, she turns and sees, but once again does not recognize the man before her, presuming he is a gardener. He also asks her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" Suspecting he has moved the body, she pleads with the man to show her where his body is. Jesus then calls her by name, Mary, and her eyes are opened as she recognizes her beloved teacher and Lord. Jesus then says to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father." In one way, this is rather odd and seems a bit unfair, as while Mary is told not to hold on to Jesus, 1 week later, Jesus will tell Thomas to touch the scars in his hands and the wound in his side. But Mary is not being told to not touch Jesus physically, but to let go of him spiritually, psychologically. Mary's relationship to Jesus can no longer be the same as it was in his earthly life before his death. And Mary needs to let go of the old way of relating to Jesus and begin a new adventure of faith. Mary is then told to go and speak to the disciples, to be, as our Roman Catholic brothers and sisters refer to Mary Magdalene, the apostle to the apostles, the first to be able to declare, "I have seen the Lord." One of the particularly wonderful things about John's account of the resurrection is that it acknowledges that belief may vary from one person to another. Peter enters the tomb without hesitation. The beloved disciple is more cautious. But once he enters the tomb, he believes, but lacks understanding. Mary Magdalene experiences the resurrection of Jesus in yet another way and comes to see and believe. So it is with us today. Our belief in the resurrection is not simply a creed that we recite or a story that we read from a holy book written long ago or an idea we hope people will consider. The resurrection takes the old, old story and retells it in such ways that it becomes a part of our own story, the living story of our own lives. Sometimes our faith is robust and strong. Sometimes we believe but don't really understand what we believe. And sometimes we find Jesus in the darkness and the shadows, and it can take a long time to recognize him. What matters is finding in the empty tomb the hope we need for our own journey, with its abundant joys and hopes, but also its struggles, losses, and disappointments too. This sermon will be the last one I preach here at Holy Trinity Cathedral, and this will be the last Eucharist I celebrate with you. I'm grateful that it is on Easter Sunday, because the resurrection reminds us that our endings, however bittersweet, are not final. New life comes, and like the first disciples, we might doubt, stumble, flee, and fall. But like Mary Magdalene at the empty tomb, we will also experience resurrection. Christ is risen. Hallelujah.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen. Hallelujah.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
In our orders of service, we turn to page 7. Would you please stand and let us together affirm the faith of the Church?
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through whom all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate with the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified.
who has spoken through Christ. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the world and for the Church. Please be seated.
Heavenly Father, you have delivered us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your Son. Grant that, as his death has recalled us to life, so his continual presence in us may raise us to eternal joy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of new life, we pray for the world. Bring the light and peace of the gospel to all the nations of the earth, and make it subject to your gentle rule. We pray for peace throughout the world, that the risen Lord will guide the human family away from violence and towards new efforts for peace in all areas of war, violence, poverty, and disease, especially in Palestine and Israel, Ukraine and Russia, Ecuador and Haiti. Lord, in your mercy, God of new life, we pray for the Church, that your people may radiate the light and life of Christ. Enable us to continue the mission of bringing hope, meaning, and love to all in our society. We pray for isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the good news of Easter. For all who are confused or doubting their faith, that they may experience the risen Lord and know his presence. For our Bishop Clarence and for all the clergy and people of our diocese and our parish, that we may follow Jesus faithfully and keep the light of Christ burning brightly in our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of new life, we pray for our community, that we may provide for those who lack food, work, or shelter. We pray for greater respect and appreciation of human life, that all may recognize your gift in each human life and nurture that life each day. For healing of hearts and relationships, that the risen Lord will open the path to reconciliation and healing amongst families, communities, and co-workers. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of new life, we pray for the sick, for all who are burdened by sickness, disease, or chronic illness, that you may reveal the light of your presence to those in need, distress, or sorrow. We remember all those we know in need of your healing presence at this time, for all on our parish list of prayer, and all who we know personally. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of new life, we give you thanks and praise that through Jesus, the source of our salvation, you bring us to glory through his death and resurrection. Surround with your saints and angels those who have died trusting in your great love, that, according to your promise, all who have died in the faith of the resurrection may be raised on the last day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers.
Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Christ is risen. Alleluia.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
please share with those around you a sign of God's peace.
Peace be with you. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. Alleluia.
My arms stretch out, lifting me high. Alleluia.
I have risen, I am with you still. Alleluia. You have laid your hand upon me. Alleluia.
Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. Alleluia.
The Lord is truly risen. Alleluia. To him be glory and power for all the ages of eternity. Alleluia.
Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. Alleluia. My arms stretch out, lift me high. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine. And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Thank you.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Come, let us celebrate the feast. Draw near with faith to feed on Christ in your hearts. With thanksgiving.
Alleluia.
Everyone is most welcome to receive communion today. Sacrament will be given in both kinds, bread and wine. If you do not wish to share the common cup, it is our practice here to receive communion in one kind and bread only. Please refrain from dipping or attempting the bread in the cup. All are invited, all are welcome.
disciples in faith, that we may witness to the resurrection and show your glory to all the world. Father,
we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out of the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Amen.
Father Ken, I said, I remember you said that you don't like a fuss, but we can't let the occasion go unnoticed without a few words of thanks. And if Stephanie could come up, please. So Father Ken, 10 years ago, at your installation when you introduced yourself, you said that your family was your greatest asset to your ministry. So we thank the Gutcher family for their support of Father Ken. To Zoe and Jacob, thank you. Thank you for being leaders of our youth and sharing your talents with us. We've had the pleasure to watch you grow into fine young people and begin on your own independent paths. I hope you'll always feel at home in Wangaratta. Stephanie, diligent, tireless, charitable. A typical sight, first thing on the morning of an event, will be to see Stephanie with 6 or more slow cookers on the go. Thanks to her dedication, the cathedral is renowned for its hospitality. Stephanie has selflessly spent her own time to manage the shop, curate events and exhibitions. Her contributions are far too numerous to mention here. She's more precious than jewels. Father Ken, thank you for being Dean of our Cathedral. We've shared a memorable decade. You forged a path to creatively minister during COVID lockdowns. It must have felt surreal 4 years ago to celebrate an entirely online Easter Mass. Your time here at the Cathedral has been a significant time for me and my family. My son has taken communion. He's an apprentice crucifer. A few weeks ago you spoke about children being included in worship, and in this way you've been very impactful on his spiritual growth and education, and I know it will stay with him forever. So this is just one of my own personal reflections of my appreciation. I'm sure every member of our congregation will have in their own hearts a recollection of a time when you guided or uplifted them. Perhaps they felt that during a sermon it was as if you were speaking directly to them with a message that perfectly answered a question or uncertainty on their mind. Thank you for leading us with your ministry and all you've done, along with your family. The day-in, day-out maintenance of the cathedral and grounds, your grace in the face of the flooding rains, the earthquake, the beehives, the cockatoos. Thank you for the Lenten studies, pastoral care, home visits, hospital visits, for leading prayer for the greater community on occasions such as Anzac Day, for the baptisms, weddings and funerals. Thank you for being a friend. In the words of a member of our congregation, Father Ken, 10 years ago I had the courage to walk into a church again. I asked you to pray for Nathan Lee Hancock. You did this, but you also gave me faith and hope again. Today, I come to pray for you. I hope all the happiness and joy goes with you and your family. Our deep loss is someone else's immense gain. God bless and goodbye. So I could go on, but I'm sure that the members of the congregation will want to thank you individually and wish you well. But for now, on behalf of your flock, thank you, Father Kim, Stephanie, Zoe and Jacob. We wish you a blessed Easter and all the best for the future. And now we have a small presentation to make.
Thank you, Imogen, for your very kind words. I'd like to thank everyone who supported the ministry of the cathedral and my ministry over the last 10 years. I'm not going to thank people individually because I'm sure to forget someone, and I don't want to have people's last memories of me being the time I forgot to mention them. But I would like to mention one person in particular, and that is Stephanie. As Imogen said at my induction, I said my family is my greatest asset, and that's very true. In another parish, I heard a couple talking. I overheard them. Eavesdropping is a terrible word. I overheard them. And they said, "Oh, Father Ken's very good, but it's really Stephanie who's the talented one." And I was upset by that, not because that was an offensive comment, but because they'd stumbled on the truth and they'd worked it out for themselves, which was a bit of a shock. My thanks go to Stephanie, especially, for the last 10 years. She's gone over and above as a dean's wife and as someone in the parish, and I thank her for her support, for putting up with my my something. Fill in the blank. Putting up with me and for supporting me so wonderfully over this last decade. So, thank you.
Thank you.
our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do this will, working in you what is pleasing in his Son. In the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
In the name of Christ, Amen. Alleluia, alleluia.